Thank you for the beautiful treatment, the beautiful music. It's lovely to have you here sharing at the 9 o'clock. Thank you so much. Your music just sets the tone and opens our hearts, so thank you. The reading, thank you, Chris. The reading is very strong because it really allows ourselves to anchor into one of the strongest ideas of the teaching of Ernest Holmes. And sometimes we can get so hung up in some of the lingo of the words that Ernest Holmes uses. And he takes these words, though, from all of the master teachers that were before him. And this idea of what we impress upon the subjective mind. And what is the outpicturing in our world? This is very, very important for us to really allow ourselves to be relaxed with, into the knowing that the first and foremost idea in all of the faith paths, it is done unto you as you believe. And so the ideas this month, we're pointing to prosperity because sometimes in our spiritual journey, we tend to look at all the ways that we can cultivate the space of our heart and how we can serve in all these different areas. And then when it comes to money, we become like, mine. And we don't really allow that energy of spirit to flow there when money is God in action. Money is God in action. Now that is a phrase that was coined by many of the teachers, and I don't know which one actually takes credit for it, whether it's Raymond Charles Barker or Eric Butterworth, but the idea of money in action. What does action mean? Action means moving. It doesn't mean sticking it somewhere and watching it and holding it and wishing for it and worrying about it. It's interesting because as I get older at work, they've seen me there for over 30 years. And so some of those people are saying, when are you retiring? And so I'm not sure if they're saying it to me because I still feel really young and vital, or if they see me limp and they're wondering and they're feeling sorry for me, how much longer for you? And I feel like I'm in a, sometimes like, well, I'm not in a prison. I can choose any time to say no more. But that always leads to, well, how's my 401k doing? And then I'll know, as if that's going to define my future. But it's a question that we live with in our world, our 401ks, our retirement, watching the economy, listening to the news. And so what's important here is to know that we live amongst those ideas. They are planted seeds in our consciousness, but what is more important is to see it rightly. That's what Jesus was exploring, his ideas always is to see things rightly. Don't try to change everything that's out in your experience, but to allow yourself to really deepen in the awareness that you truly are reflecting out into your world with right action, with right thought, with your sense of deep connection to your soul. So this idea of the law of visualization, we are taking some of our talks from this book, Spiritual Economics by Eric Butterworth. And he says on the title, on the front cover, you deserve abundance. Now, do you all feel that? Oh yeah, for me, I deserve abundance. And this book is designed to help you reshape your attitude about money, spirituality, and personal prosperity. Personal prosperity is not just about how much money that you can acquire, but truly cultivating the gifts of spirit in such a way that they flow endlessly through you as you. So this particular chapter that Eric is pointing to is the law of visualization. And I thought to myself, how can I do two talks on the law of visualization? It's kind of done after I tell them just to close their eyes and think of something. But when I really got over my anxiety about that, I looked at his chapter, I read it several times, and I thought, It's really the law itself as expressed by him. Let me tell you exactly what he says this law is. Again, I already said it one time, and you'll keep hearing this, though. You will realize, under the law of visualization, the greatest need is not to set it right, but to see it rightly. Keep that echoing through you. What am I not seeing rightly in my world? We want to change how we see it. We cannot change the outer experience. Try to recognize how many times we've had that opportunity of anxiety cross through us when it comes to dealing with money, and we're thinking, well, let me just change some things out here. James Allen starts his quote, "The vision that you glorify your mind," the vision, okay, what we glorify in our mind, "the ideal that you enthrone in your heart," mind and heart, "this you will build your life by." Okay, what you glorify your mind on and what you enthrone into your heart, "this you will build your life by, this you will become." This I will become. And I'm trying, as I share this with you, try to notice the ways you separate your idea of financial good outside of your spiritual practice. Ernest Holmes says, "It follows that the range of our possibilities at the present time does not extend far beyond the range of our present concepts. As we bring ourselves to a greater vision, we induce a greater concept and thereby demonstrate more in that experience. In this way, there is continuous growth and unfoldment taking place. We do not expect to give a treatment today for our prosperity and have $1 million tomorrow. But little by little, we can unfold our consciousness through acquisition of greater and still greater mental equivalent until at last we shall be made free." So here's a very important key ingredient. What is your mental equivalent? So many times I've been in prosperity classes and we're asked that question, you know, what is your goal? What would be financial good for you? And we kick it around for a while, and I did this in the summer class, and every time I ask this question, we get really shy because inside of us there's this, I want 10 million, but we say, well, maybe 25,000. You know, there's this part of us that wants to declare a big dream, but then we kind of go real shyly, well, maybe just a little bit. Could I have just a little bit more? And then that's what we invest our feelings in, and ultimately that's a mental equivalent that you then are demonstrating out through your experience. So you want to be free? Allow the ideas of the boundaries that you put upon prosperity when the invitation for you to give, allow yourself to give, to allow that flow to break through from you and to watch the many ways that we put walls of limitation around our good. Visualization and mental equivalent, those two ingredients together allow for you to have a prosperous life, a life of freedom. Emerson says, we animate what we see, and we see what we animate. The reason for this being that only as we truly see can that divine harmony be reflected through us and animate that which is seen. Oh, Emerson. It takes long contemplation to really grasp this idea, but he's inviting us to truly live in awareness. Live in awareness. Live in this awareness of God's good ever flowing, to become the master of new moments in our experience, to be awake in our consciousness. One of my favorite sayings from Paramahansa Yogananda is, how does God find you? Awake and ready. Awake and ready for what? To relive your perceptions from yesterday and to start worrying? I'm awake and, oh boy, I have a talk to do at 9 and I'm not sure where it's going to go. Or, I'm awake And I'm choosing to be an instrument of God's voice today, and I'll see what happens. Amen. There's two different ways that I can allow that consciousness to flow through me, to live, to really live in the awareness. When we have all these invitations for you to join the harvest dinner, and I want you to watch. Watch what your mind does. Watch when you go through looking at the bookstores. I don't have enough for that. If I allow my money to channel there, I might not have enough for what? We don't even know what that what is, but we hold it in this place of yipes, of something. Something's going to happen, and I'm not sure what it is with our retirement, with our health, with this idea of worry. Is that living in awareness? Is that living in the consciousness? You know, it's this idea of projecting out this idea into our experiences is always impressed by our experiences from before. So the spiritual journey, the spiritual truth is asking us always to polish and to reflect back to ourselves, what am I bringing into the experience? What dead weight? What old ideas? What did my mom say about this? And a lot of us at my age grew up from that generation of our parents surviving the Depression. So, oh my goodness, there was so much not enoughness that went through in our upbringing. And to break through some of those thought patterns were really challenging for me. And I was reflecting on this the other day when in the Foundations class when we were talking about our history with money and the idea of tithing. And I remember where I balk with that when I first was introduced to that concept, because it took me a long time to collect my dimes for that little book. See the bitterness in my voice? I had my dime folder, and then at Sunday school, my mom turned it in. And I'm thinking, that was mine. And it was an idea that I needed to recognize that I didn't understand the intention behind myself collecting my allowance and putting those dimes in there, that it was going to go to God. I thought it was for me. And then I thought, when she was teaching me at that time, it is your intention, your spiritual purpose in this world, to give, to feed the divine, to feed the areas in your world where the divine feeds you. And so when we offer those offering baskets, we see in our mind's eye overflowing with your good, overflowing with your heart. And we invite you into that spiritual practice to not cling to that envelope when it goes by, to not feel like it's kind of hard to tear the check out, but to feel like, God's good is moving through. This is God in action by means of me. It's a freeing experience because we no longer qualify where the money's going to go or how it's going to look out there. We just know that we have given from the depth of our heart. So this is this idea of thinking clearly and not limiting the spirit to fulfill its greater purpose. We turn our thoughts at all times and all conditions and all ways to the divine for wholeness, for completion. We train our eyes to see properly. We see, oftentimes we react with attitudes and feelings. Now let me share with you how easily this is, taking it away from the idea of money prosperity, but just how we can co-create our experience out in the world. Some of you might be sick of hearing this, but I'm going to tell you one more time because I can, because I got the microphone. But I got my jury notice, and oftentimes we get those, and I want you to notice what it feels like when you get one of those. Is it, thank God, I get to go judge. I get to go be responsible for somebody's life. Thank you, God, for this opportunity. And you show up, and I showed up, but that was not my experience was, oh shoot, I got tagged, I got the booby prize. And so I, already, I started creating my experience, and I had a heck of experience. I walked in that courtroom, that jury room, there wasn't a seat left. And you know how big that is for those of you that have served. And so what does that do? That pushes every shy button I have. I'm thinking, I wish I would have wore something else because I have to stand here in front of all these people and they're judging me. They're looking at the back of my hair and I don't even know what the back of, you know, I started doing all of this stuff. Horrible experience, horrible experience. May I sit there? May I sit here? That chair's taken. Oh, gosh. You know, and then they say, okay, you can go forward now if you have this, or that reason. Please come to the front. And I'm thinking, oh, God, everybody has to come to the front and everybody's staring. And I was watching people have reasons why they didn't have to be there, and I thought, I don't have one. I didn't think of one. I don't have one. And so I started to try to recreate it by thinking, I am here to serve. I am here to judge. Anyway, I did try one thing, and it didn't work, so I was told to sit back down. And then we go into the courtroom, and then the courtroom was terrifying because I chose not to go to the bathroom when they told me because I didn't have to. I had to go right when they told us to go to that judge. And so when I went in, there was no more seats left again, so I had to sit in the jury box, so I felt like I was already chosen. And so I'm sitting there in the jury box and everybody else is over there and I feel like I was guilty. Right away I feel like I'm lying, I'm guilty, I did it. And so here's, and I'm thinking, what is with my mind? I'm creating this hideous experience. And then the judge speaks, and he was just total Mr. Authority. And in my mind, in my judgment of him, he wasn't nice, and I didn't like him right away. And so then I started getting confused because the more he was, do you mind hearing all this? And I hope he's listening. So I was going through all the reasons as he was saying, you know, if you didn't have your reason excused out there, you have another chance. I'm saying it really nicely, but he didn't say it. He said it intimidatingly. And so I started going through thinking, well, let's see, I don't know. And I started thinking about all the things I could rearrange. And then I found out it's a 6-week case. And I went, oh, 6 weeks of my life in here? And I still couldn't think of anything. So I thought, you know, I'm the best one. I'm chosen. I'm the best one here. I don't know this case. I don't know this man. I can't think of a reason not to be here. And then so all of this was going through my mind. And then they started to go through the witness list. And they said, if you don't know anybody on the witness list, you can leave and come back on Thursday. And so I thought, okay, that's me. And so I left. I got home and I went, oh my God, I've got doing the woman's retreat. Of course I can't go. Of course I can't go. And so I thought, I'll just tell him. I'll just show up. I'll dress differently and I'll show up. And so I went in and I tried to explain them, thinking they would just kindly say, you may go now. But no, I had to go and we had to line up again. And there was about 20 of us that had to go into the courtroom and he nailed us. Oh boy. He let us know how lousy citizens we were not to think of what we thought of on Tuesday and that we thought of it on Wednesday. And so I'll just end it there. I didn't get chosen. He did let me go after I was completely embarrassed. But what I'm saying is, when I opened up that jury notice, I started my experience right there. I started it right there. I said, oh my God, I got jury duty. And I have watched this throughout the week. That was a little story, but there's experiences all the time, and I watch myself say, oh, I feel so sorry for mental health in our community. That was a conversation I was having with somebody. And the conversation back was, it's all divine right order. And I'm thinking, no, it's not. But then I realized, yes, it is. People are being led all the time, and I'm choosing to see it as suffering. Do you see what I'm out picturing by the way I visualize the suffering? I have the opportunity to lift it up, to hold it up into a higher light, to really feel and to know a greater truth is being revealed. We see what our awareness has conditioned us to see. My awareness has conditioned me to see suffering in the world. And I'm not sorry about that, because it's given me a very compassionate heart, a tender heart. But I'm also walking a spiritual journey here. And if I want to be a master of my awareness, I want to choose to see all suffering released in that moment with my consciousness, bathing that person with a greater idea of who they are, and not limiting that out, picturing in my mind of woe is them and poor them, not me. I have suddenly divided myself. It's no longer wholeness. Do you see what a path we're on? This idea of wholeness and walking in this truth is not denying or separating, but walking this walk with such a way that we visualize and we outpicture in our world this wholeness, this truth, this good, this outpicturing for all beings, not just ourselves. Everything is shaped by the experience of the past and held. It's held there by the strength of our opinions. But if we introduce that ingredient of our faith will set us free. Because we recognize all the time, everything that we see in our world, and when we walk in the presence and we walk in that awareness, is an opportunity of prayer. To see things rightly, and to not be judging, and not to be judging and framing everything back to an old experience. Do we set things rightly, or do we see things rightly? So ask yourself, stay in the idea of wholeness with God. Stay in the idea of wholeness with God as you demonstrate this truth. Remember, we're not trying to change anything that's out there, but we're changing the way we see it. And when we change the way we see it, we change the way we speak to it. There was this whole part in the first part of his chapter about how what our retina does, what our eyes do when we even see anything in the first place. We just get dots and glimpses and things turn upside down in our head. And I'm going, oh, science. I can't even explain that to him. And then there was another part where I was reading about visualization. It was talking about quantum physics and the particles and all this. Now, I can't go there either. That's Mary's stuff. So, but what I can say is I realize that we have these images that are projected onto the screen of our mind, and we have this choice to set ourselves free. And Troward, and this is who Mary's going to be teaching on, and he's fabulous to really get into some of his philosophies. He says, having seen and felt the end, listen to that, having seen, so you're visualizing, and felt, you must feel it, you see with the mind, you feel with the heart, having seen and felt the end, you have willed the means to the realization of the end. You have willed the means of the realization of the end. It is the law. It is the law. As we hold and anchor ourselves into that, what do we want to see? What do we want to see in our bank account, in our charity work? And what do we want to see out there? What is the soul of our money doing? Is it a mere reflection of our longing in our heart of to serve all people? That's what the creative expression of money, this God in action, is really meant to do. It makes your money feel so much more fun to give with that generosity of the heart, and there's no monkey mind distracting you of the not enoughness in the world. So it is done unto you as you believe. So you want to see the end. You want to see the outpicturing in your mind's eye. And you want to create it then as you go. You allow that will of your nature, that creative energy, that juice within you, that God-given power to move through you and express this. So what gets in the way? Oh, a little three-letter word called but. So watch your but in the world. Watch how many times you're going, yeah, I got what Sue was saying. I got that. But my car just broke down, you know, the energy of all of the what could happens. And you know what starts that chain of events? Is our worry. So the invitation here this week is to really be the gatekeeper of your mind and to watch what worry does. Because we can be set free into this knowing and feel empowered by, oh my gosh, I can really allow this world and my world and everybody around me to prosper. That's up to me. I'm the master of my experience. I see it. And then we start to worry. And what does worry do? It's going to create that undesirable condition. It will create it, sure enough. Jury duty for you too. It'll create it. So worry, eventually, if you worry enough, if you don't catch it and turn it around with affirmation of the heart, you're going to see yourself worried and outpicturing these experiences in your mind. So it can be anything. It can be catching the flu, getting shingles, being in debt, being jobless, worrying about what's going on in the government. Do you want to worry, or do you want to see that it could be a greater downfall of something that wasn't working anyway? And to see that now, with my creative mind and energy, I choose to be the 100th monkey that allows the consciousness to shift and propel itself into greater abundance globally for the whole world. So we can keep hoarding and worrying about our finances in such a way, or we can allow ourselves to just release all of that and not allow these outside events to pull all our strings. Divine right action is unfolding all the time. What is divine right action? It's the thoughts that you're creating. It is done unto us as we believe. It's done unto the world as you believe and you hold. So the invitation here is to see abundance everywhere. When I was inviting you into that meditation earlier, I've done visualizations, and I'm just like, I'll be like, visualize that you're on the beach, and so I'll be on the beach. And then they'll say, and it's stormy. And I thought, oh, stormy? I was in the sun, you know. So I try to erase it. And I'm so anxious about other people's imagery coming to me that I never, and then they're done. And I'm still erasing my picture, trying to get it the way they wanted me to. It's our creation. When you visualize, I want you to be empowered to visualize your world, your outpicturing. So watch the events that pull your strings. See abundance everywhere and not lack. See spiritual connection everywhere, everywhere. Start living your world from within with these eyes that take in imagery that is so beautiful and so innocent and so longing for greater expression. And you are the creator, the co-creator with the one, as you do that with love. So I'm going to close with a treatment from Raymond Charles Barker, who is so powerful in this. And I want you to really feel the truth. And this is a treatment that he writes in the end of his book, How to Be Healthy, Wealthy, and Happy. So join with me, close into that place. I now subconsciously accept this treatment. There is only one creative cause, God. There is only one mind, God. There is only one life, God. There is only one substance, God. This present universe is the glory of God. It is moving, flexible, fluid creation. It is alive with life, the abundance and the richness of God. I abide in prosperity. Mine created me in order that it might act through me. Therefore, I am receptive to its abundance. I am receptive to the circulation in my life in the form of money. Money is God's idea of circulation in my world of finance, and I accept this idea completely. I appreciate this idea, and I like it. Money being God in action is absolute good. It is wholesome, it is a blessing to man, and I am now prospered with it. I have no fear of lack, for I believe that I have plenty of money. It's God's activity in my world. It's God's activity in my bank account. It's God's activity in my investments. It's God's activity in everything to which I lay my hands. This money is flowing. This money is free. I do not attempt to lock it up. I do not put a fence around it. It is God's money, and I let it flow. I let it flow out as I release it. I know that it comes back to me pressed down, shaken together, and running over. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I am now free in money. I rejoice in it. I appreciate it, and I thank God for it. I have money forevermore. Amen. And so it is. So enjoy, enjoy allowing your shift to happen without any worry or any buts. So it is. Thank you. Let them have their moment to get to their beautiful music, you two, as always, as always. And they have wonderful offerings in the table out there to take them home with you. And beautiful treatment, very eloquently spoken from the heart. So I'm speaking of the heart. It's one of the first times I've ever spoken with my Charlie gone. I feel like half my heart's gone, so don't pick on me. He's my buffer. He's traveling today, so I bless him on his journey, and I miss him already. But today we're talking about the law of visualization, and we're relating it to true prosperity. And I invite you to really pay attention to your heart when I speak, because if you feel triggered, if you feel annoyed by anything I have to say, it's not me. Thank you, God, for that clearing. It's really what you are bringing into the audience, into the audience, and into the hearing and into the knowing of your own self. It's what you've experienced before, and so you might have certain predestined ideas of how you're going to receive a talk or a message. So the invitation is to sit back and get comfortable and just be aware. Just be aware, and inviting that awareness in such a way that this concept, this law of visualization, this law of seeing, of truly seeing, you leave here today with an awakened understanding of truly what that means. This reading, thank you, Chris, so crisp in the reading, what man thinks, so what you think, what you suppose. Sometimes we're just thinking, yeah, that was a little bit of a nasty thought there, but it went by. But you know what? If you don't attend to that and say, you know, I really, if you were cursing someone as they cut you off somewhere, you need to turn that around. And the invitation is to be awake to that and to say, oh, I bless you on the way. May you arrive safely wherever you're going. May I be safe. May you be well. And you release that idea of letting a thought go unattended to that might curse or harm another person. See, you think you're finished with that thought, but you've planted that seed. And then how do you water that seed? They become seeds planted in our consciousness. And if we don't tend to the soil daily and reap what we want to truly harvest, we might be having quite an experience out there in our world. So this law of visualization is to realize the greatest need is not to see everything else perfect out there in your world, you know, not to worry about that so much, but to see how am I looking out at my world? How am I seeing it rightly? How am I seeing it? How is the God in me seeing my world out there? Very important. To take that seat of really honoring that you're going to see your world rightly. And I talked about this quite a bit in relation to your prosperity and your abundance at the earlier service. And I want to extend that a little bit more into the idea of the soul of money. I have this wonderful book by Lynn Twist. It's called The Soul of Money. And it talks about really allowing our inner resources, our good, all that we work for, to be mirrored out into our world and serving our world in a way that is truly empowering our world. So I will be leaping back into this beautiful text that they wrote, that she wrote, and also our whole month we're talking about prosperity and abundance. And I invite you to pick up this book in the bookstore, Eric Butterworth's Spiritual Economics, because he really points to a lot of the ideas. And if you're in an area where you have felt, why are we talking about money in church? Money is God in action. Money is what we have created, and to allow our greater good to be expressed and to receive that greater good. So money is God. God is this money shown up in the action of how we serve others. So we are allowing ourselves this opportunity to see abundance everywhere, everywhere, that there is no lack. So we have maybe gotten very used to ourselves mumbling the words of not enough in our checkbook when we're paying our bills. We have taken that seat when we have looked out into our life. We have taken on that concept of worry. Now remember what worry is, because if you're allowing yourself to worry, you are dwelling on ideas and then allowing those worry ideas to be made manifest. Do you see? You are feeding that. So it's important to recognize when you're all stirred up into that state of worry, because there is truly no lack. Again, button pushers here, because you could say, well, she doesn't know. She doesn't know what I'm living through. And I recognize that when you have that question in your mind, when you have that hesitation of heart, know that I'm speaking from a place of wholeness, that we are not separate. And that's the beauty about the soul of money, the soul of our greater good expressed out into the world. We begin to operate from an idea of a spiritual connection everywhere, everywhere. So look at your idea as I speak about money, because it can be a trigger for a lot of people. Look to know if you look at your finances with fear, with joy, or with depression. It's kind of that described as the mood meter of how you deal with this. And how are you living? How is this out picturing in your world? You see, it is not separate. The prosperity and the abundance of the world is not separate from a spiritual life, from your spiritual good. I had an opportunity to listen to Ram Dass one time, and he was describing how he was in a little cafe, and he had just was feeling really prosperous because he just got a phone call that he received this incredible inheritance. And he was living very frugal in his spiritual journey. And he just, all of a sudden, he had this wealth. And it had been invested. And he just felt like, you know, I'm on top of the world. I can go and just do whatever I want today. And he thought, you know, in fact, I think I'll even go have a donut. And he got up and he went by to get his donut. And he looked, and on the newspaper it said, you know, Dow Jones down, I don't know this terminology, stock crashes. And he was going, oh, it's gone, it's all gone. And so he didn't get a donut that day. But he said, you know, we can ride these waves of up and down, and we can be joy-filled because we think we have it all, and then we'll catch a news title and we think, no, I have nothing. See, I worried about it, now it's gone. Yeah, so be it. That's how it works. That's what Troward said very, very powerfully in his writing, and I have to read this because it's his words, and he's inviting us to truly live in that awareness, to be really aware of your consciousness. And Troward, where are you? He'll show up again. He doesn't want to be spoken about right now. I'll go back to the idea of somebody even more powerful maybe than Troward, and you might know Jesus. So Jesus reminds us not to ever judge anything by appearances, but to judge with right judgment, and to again look at the outside events that are pulling our strings. So we need to invite ourselves into the opportunity. Visualizing has to do with vision, has to do with allowing ourselves to be that vehicle of expressing this divine connection to all that is. And so when we're looking out at our world, completely reliving every other experience again and again, because we have so many preconceived ideas, oh, this happened, so therefore that's going to be the outpicturing, we're not living awareness. We are not living with that divine connection. We are living from an idea that our ego has framed for us. So if you truly want to allow your life to be a mirror of your soul, to allow this understanding of who you are and what you stand for to be mirrored out into your world, you let go. You let go of the worry, you let go of the fear, and you allow your life to be a reflection of all the true values that you hold in your heart. There's an important quote that says, "He that dwelleth in the place most high," so we are dwelling in that place, in that higher level of consciousness that is untainted, untouched, and in that one mind, that connection to the divine, as we dwell in that place of most high, holding that vision, holding that idea, anchoring to these spiritual truths that we are all one. There is a wholeness to this truth. There is no division. When we allow ourselves to dwell there and to allow our vision to be seen, everything that we see is from that state of consciousness. There shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. There is that idea that we are dwelling with this protective umbrella of consciousness, just holding all that we see, all that we hold dear. So with right judgment, we begin to see from within as things can be. There's a difference there, as things can be. That's exciting. That's exciting to think of allowing your ideas in your heart and in your mind to connect and to allow yourself to be the co-creator. It's not about what you have or don't have or what you're worrying about. It's not about trying to accumulate more and holding on to it for I'm not sure what reason, but we're holding on to it. And then when you're allowing yourself, I can let go. I can trust and I can allow myself to vision and to visualize this greater idea of my life unfolding. There's so much race consciousness that when we are working upstream against that race consciousness coming towards us, it takes great strength and fortitude to paddle our way into clarity, into consciousness of knowing that we are allowing a greater dream, a greater vision to unfold, not just for ourselves. Remember, we're whole, we're one. What I do for me in my spiritual work with prosperity, I do for all of this center, I do for all of you. And likewise, when you are the gatekeepers of your soul and you allow yourselves to really let go of that dollar, to allow it to be God in action, you do it for the whole. And what do we do here? We reach out into the community. What do? We take our shoes that are still in perfect condition and we give them to other people because they deserve them. They deserve that. What do? We take our time and talent and we create food for the Hope Van. And you can see Reverend Pam about that when that's happening again. But what do for this community? We allow this to be God in action. We allow our wealth to continue to pour through this center and to be an expression in the community and the world. We allow this idea, when we're allowing ourselves that freedom, we become like a magnet drawing more good. Oh my gosh, I've got more good. I gotta give it out. Oh, here comes some more. That's how it works. It keeps coming to you, through you, as you, and you keep expressing it out. It's about the idea of being free in our spirit to allow this. I am so excited about this class, this thing called you. There's a passage that Ernest Holmes says, and I love this, because sometimes we can look at our finances and you can say, when you go home going, well, I don't see God here so much. Seems a little skimpy to me. But where has God been all this time? God had not been anywhere. The divine is always present. The divine is always present and appears whenever recognized. As you enter more completely into the conscious union with life, when you allow yourself to settle into that awareness and stillness and that beingness, that awareness, that presence, when you allow yourself to be there, you'll realize that the universe holds as much good for you as you can take, that you can take only what you can give. Oh, there's that piece. So you're creating this mental equivalent. You're creating this container of greater good to flow through you, through being diligent at the mind gate, to allow what thoughts are coming through to you as you express and bless with your words out into the world. How is this flowing through you? And how are you allowing yourself to be fed back? When someone says with great gratitude, "Thank you so much. Let me take you out for lunch." "Oh no, I just couldn't. I just couldn't." Yes, you can. Yes, you can. They want to offer their good to you. So you say yes to every opportunity where good's flowing back to you. The good is always in action, in fluid motion. That's what God's energy is. It's about flow. It's about this connection. So I love that. It holds as much for you as you can take. So look at how you are opening to that greater good. And then recognize that you can only take what you can give. You can't hold on to it and say, "Yay, I finally got it. I finally got it." Then give it up. And watch, it just keeps coming. It just keeps coming. I think that's powerful. This idea that God is your source. You want to see all things from this point of view. You want to see appearances of things and see it with God thoughts. See it with that divine knowing. Center yourself. So you see, the vision, the visualizing is you're centering yourself in a reality that you're connected to a circulation of good, and that you are aligned with the right spirit, and this right image is flowing through you, and there is no sense of rejection. And as you recognize that God is your constant companion and your constant source, you are affirming this truth, and you're allowing your mind to be synchronized with this flow from the infinite. And you allow these kinds of thoughts to lead you into the kind of conditions that you want to experience in your world. There is an ongoing message that I hear many times in counseling and in treatment, where we really want to do something in our life, but we keep falling back on what went before. So it's an example, if you wanted to go exercise and you're saying, "Well, tomorrow's the day. Tomorrow I'm going to get up early and I'm going to get on that treadmill. You betcha." And then that day comes, Paul says this in Romans, and I think this is so clever, because he said, "But what I would, that do I not." You go, Paul. For what I would, that I do not, but what I hate, that I do. See, he was soul-searching that, and I hear that all the time. We're always soul-searching. Why do I keep doing the things I don't want to do? Why do I keep limiting my flow of good? Why do I have such a small idea of myself? Well, these are the answers. These are the spiritual nudgings for you to allow this true prosperity to be a flow that allows it to be a continuous flow, a flow, not a fluctuation, a flow. So fluctuation happens when you watch the news. Fluctuation happens when you start to believe the news. Okay? The news is important to keep us propelled forward and to keep us in our spiritual practice. So you allow yourself to live with an idea. This is what Eric Butterworth says. Prosperity is a way of living, thinking. It's not just about money or things, because poverty is a way of living and thinking. Poverty is a way of living and thinking. It's not just a lack of money or things. It's a spiritual well-being. Prosperity is your key to a sense of well-being. There is a divine intelligence that knows and is in charge of your life. You are open and receptive and obedient to its rich instruction and guidance. This affirmation, you are activated by divine love and guided by divine order. I am activated by divine love. I am activated by divine love. Let that resonate in your heart. I am activated by divine love and I am guided by divine order. What is divine order? It's flow. It's flow. There's no limitation. There's no block. You are divinely guided always, always, always. Use your visualization. Use that power of your mind to allow yourself to visualize a greater good unfolding. You want to keep it flowing. You don't want to get it hung up in, as I spoke about in the earlier service, that nasty three-letter word, but. Or you don't want to get it caught up in worry. So you look at your buts and your worries, and you allow yourself to go, oh, my gosh, of course it's unfolding this way. I've been clinging and worrying about my future. You just need to let it go and allow your imagination to lead you, the creative power of your imagination, to lead you into every direction where you get these definite pictures to build and fulfill your life experience. You want to see this money bulging from your wallet. Why not? Oh, my wallet's so big. Here, let me give it all into the basket so I can get some more. Just because I want to give more. So I'm going to allow it to image. Everything that God wants you to experience, allow yourself to image that and be passionate about it. This idea of where has God been all the time really struck me last week when I just loved it when Dr. Kim Kaiser was here and the way he spoke to us. And he mentioned that idea of the gorilla walking through the room. Did you guys catch that piece? And for some of you that hadn't seen that film, where you were instructed to watch a group of people and count how many times they passed the basketball back and forth. And so you're watching that, and you're feeling really proud of yourself. Oh, I got 15 times. And then the next question is, did you see the gorilla go through? And you're going, the gorilla go through? And sure enough, when they show the film again, that's all you see, are the people passing the basketball back and forth. But a gorilla walks through several times. And so I'm thinking, oh my gosh, God's always present, like a gorilla, always walking through. But I'm so hung up in my preconceived ideas of, you know, counting balls, how important is that? And versus God walking through. And yet, when we're nudged to wake up, to be aware, we see God passing through. Where has God been all the time? It's not been anywhere. The divine is always present and appears when you recognize that truth. As you enter more completely into that consciousness, we invite ourselves to really mirror and understand who we are and what we stand for. I point back to that because it's very important. There's a minister that I like to follow her readings, and she's a religious science minister named Reverend Ellen Grace O'Brien. And she says these words, let us learn to be prosperous. When we know that we always have enough of what we need, we always have enough of what we need, we are prosperous. To thrive and be free from fear that causes us to hoard or want more or compete with others or be jealous or envious of others. There is no lack in God's wholeness. From the God view, not from our ego view. That's the only time from our ego view that we see any scarcity at all. From God's view, it's all ours. And it just is such a welcomed experience when we allow this grace to freely flow through with us, when we have that union with life in such a way that we recognize that the universe truly is holding this good. This truly holding this good. And as I receive, I choose to give. So move money, move good, move your work, move your life expression. Don't let yourself be held up. Flow with it. Invite it in. Channel it through. Make a difference with your life's work, with your good that comes your way. So this from Lynn Twist, she shares many, many beautiful ideas here, and one of them I wanted to share with you. She says, I challenge you to use the money that flows through your life, and it does flow through all of our lives, to express the truth and context of sufficiency. I challenge you to move the resources that flow through your life toward the highest commitments and ideals, those things that you stand for. Isn't that refreshing? To know that you stand for something, that your heart is moved, whether it be for Shoes for Souls or working at a food bank, for working, doing art, whatever is moving you, you have an ideal that you stand for. I challenge you to hold money as a common trust, that we're all responsible for using it in ways that nurture and empower us in all life, our planet, and all future generations. Wow. Me? I can make that kind of change in the world. I challenge you to imbue your money with soul. That feels good, doesn't it? Yeah. Guys are squirming on your wallets in your back pocket, feeling your soul when you offer your offering today. You want to feel that, your soul, let it stand for who you are. Let it stand for your love, your heart, your word, your humanity. Oh, I think that's so refreshing to recognize taking the mundane out of every offering. When you're at the store writing your check for your goods, that you're infusing that money with your love and knowing that you are so thankful for all the ways that that store made it easy for you to just go there and pick something up. As you go and explore people that have invested a lot of money, at one time they just had to have that book or that series of tapes. They paid full price. You get it for a dollar. You can give more than that if you think it's worth more. The dollar was just an idea. Don't let it limit you. You know, I could go on and on. It's exciting to think about this. There was a, tell me, what did you say? 1521. None, one. I wanted to share this idea of the caterpillar and the butterfly, because I felt like this. There's a struggle that we have around money. We get some tension there. We get fears. There's excess that can go along with it. There's depletion. There's all these kinds of ideas. But there was a biologist that related it to being like the caterpillar. And in a certain part of the life cycle of the caterpillar, it starts to, I just love this. I feel like, oh, you're looking at me going, yeah, she's at the caterpillar stage. Because it says it consumes more fat and sluggish it gets. Because all of a sudden it's at that stage and it has this part of it of developing an excess. Inside that caterpillar, he's just wanting to hoard and eat everything in sight. And he just gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And he's thinking that he needs to take on everything that there is. But inside of him are these imaginal cells, it's called, imaginal cells of the butterfly. And those imaginal cells, they are outnumbered by the gluttony and the hoarding and the piggishness of the caterpillar. But they're still longing. They're the spiritual nature. They're the longing. They're the soul of that caterpillar, and they're longing to be expressed. So when you recognize that eventually that soul takes over, that greater good takes over when you allow yourself to vision that beauty. So the author says, when I first heard the caterpillar butterfly metaphor, I loved it. Gave me a way to see the whole world the way it was. Voracious greed, a kind of evolutionary phase. And that was refreshing for me to read that. We're just in an evolutionary phase. We're not being destroyed here by the way the world looks in certain ways. We look at the inspired, devoted, and brilliant people that are at work in so many ways, that are working so hard to nourish, to repair, to work with the families, the communities, the earth, for sustainable enterprises. They see the imaginal cells of our own transformation. Oh, that's so cool. Our own imaginal cells are coming into expression here. How? Through the spiritual teaching, through connecting to an idea that chooses to vision out into the world this greater idea of God being expressed right here and now. You are receiving that truth. That truth is flowing through you. So join with me in the absolute, where we recognize this perfect flow, this perfection. There is no need to hoard, to grasp, to worry, to fret. The abundant flow of God's good is ever present, and we as a whole recognize this truth, and we allow this truth to be outpictured in our world. We allow our greater vision to be one that holds true to these higher states of consciousness, to allow this truth, this ease, this grace, to move through each one of us, as God expressing through us, and all the forms God takes. Our money is God in action. Our money is an expression of our soul, of our values, of our truth. And we choose right here and now to let go of those past blocks that have allowed us to be less than, and we create that mental equivalent of a greater truth being expressed right here, right now on the planet by means of each one of us. So I give thanks for the evolutionary flow of God's grace. We align with this truth. We allow ourselves to move with that truth. So be it. Thank you, God, and so it is.